And we are live. Cool. What's up, Idea Chasers? I'm with Shannon Oliver, and we're going to be talking for the first time in a live format about a book that I have not read, but Shannon has, and we're going to be breaking it down a little bit. That book's The Power of Habit. I'm pumped to be able to bring you content in a new way, trying some different things out. Hopefully the sound is all right. If it's not, I mean, it's a system over a goal. Is like harkening back all the way to How to Fail at Everything and Still Win Big, or The Slight Edge. Both of those are talking about how you don't have to be successful at the beginning to ultimately be trending in the right direction. So, and that ties itself into very well with the book The Power of Habit, which is right here for those of you who have not seen the cover before. This is the habit loop that we're talking about, and Shannon knows quite a bit about this after reading the entire book. So Shannon, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, why you feel eminently qualified to teach everybody about the power of habit, to be live on the internet for the rest of time.
The most qualified.
He's easily the most qualified.
I'm super jacked about this book because about 2 years ago, I don't know if y'all have seen Ty Lopez with his here in my garage with my four cars and my seven bookshelves.
Yeah, the one that's in front of all the videos of cats that I want to watch.
Exactly, that
one. Okay, gotcha.
And now he's gotten even more douchey with his ads. But I saw that ad and I wanted I wanted to know what he knew.
Okay.
I was looking for something and was just tired of I was just tired of losing, I guess.
Okay.
And so I went to his page, hit the paywall, which is super stupid. I like that, like, Gary Vaynerchuk and some other content creators out there are actually making content free on YouTube.
Yeah.
And don't hit you with a paywall immediately. But then if you want their deeper content, they hate. Anyway, getting off topic.
Ty Lopez.
Yeah,
The Power of Habit.
Yeah, I checked out Ty Lopez.
Okay.
And I've just been in search of really good content since, whether it's books like this or other things.
You're making the camera wobble when you do that.
Okay, I did it on purpose.
Okay.
It's for dramatic effect.
We will get better as the day goes along.
Yeah, for sure. So, anyway, I was looking, and then I was in a place where there's a couple habits that I wanted to change, wanted to see how to do better at those.
Sure.
And so this book cover, it was just something about the red and yellow.
So did you pick up the book immediately after you saw the Ty Lopez ad, or what are you talking about?
No, so Ty Lopez was 2 years ago.
You read the book recently?
Yeah, Ty Lopez was 2 years ago. Since then, been reading other books. And then I got this book at the tail end of last year. Actually, I know when I started reading it. See, I track from date to date when I read a book.
That's fair.
I started it on the 14th of December.
Okay.
So, and then just finished it this month.
So you've had roughly 3 months or so to see how, you know, your habits or an awareness of your habits could change things for you.
Yeah, for sure.
That's fair.
Do you want, like, specific details or, like, how I've applied this so far?
I guess it's interesting to me that you said you've had a mindset now for a couple of years that you can change things. And but only recently, you know, picking up a book like this, has it crystallized or made clear some of the concepts that you've been filling your mind with for the past number of years? Or deeper understanding of habit? How does that work?
I guess what the book did for me, and I hope it does for other people, is it sort of gave the science behind habits and how to actually kind of hack your habits and make them work for you. So, like, these changes that I've seen being made in the last 2 years of life, I've been going through, like, just got on the self-help like train 2 years ago and been going through different things, and this book was just another step in the process.
Right on.
Like, the cover just caught me because it's just basic.
yellow and red.
Red's my favorite color, and because I was looking for more self-help content, so this just solidified, like, oh, this is how everything is working in my life and how I'm actually changing habits and how I can continue to change habits.
Okay, so what drew you, or what would draw someone to pick up this book? I mean, Simon Sinek in, you know, his TED Talk says we have to start with why. You know, we'll talk a little bit about the what of habits and mechanics of that, but why would somebody want to check out this book?
I guess, again, where I was I still had a couple habits that I've been kind of fighting.
Sure.
And so Even though I'd been changing some more periphery things, there are a couple more core habits that I wanted to change that have just been, like, my diet and exercise is one of them.
Right.
Which this guy right here, if you haven't checked out his 4-Hour Body,
shameless
book review,
plug for the 4-Hour Body.
Yes, and the book is phenomenal. I'm actually on the diet now because of his testimony, what it's done for him.
You know, it's interesting as well on that. You know, we'll get to this in just a second, but
sure.
You know, having a habit can eliminate some of the willpower that you need in order to make changes that you would want to make, or mm-hmm. you know, that you've had a hard time making in the past. I've done a number of diets or proper eating programs, but until finding a habit that I could implement through the 4-Hour Body and the slow carb diet, you know, I wasn't able to solidify that to now, like, in the past 3 months or so, losing 20 pounds. So that was my experience, and now Shannon's checking out the 4-Hour Body as well.
For sure. I'm only 2 weeks in, so...
Yeah, but you lost 7 pounds in 2 weeks.
For sure, yeah.
So
I weighed in...
Another book recommendation.
Yeah, I weighed in yesterday. It was 2 weeks. Yesterday was cheat day, Fatterday. I weighed in the morning at 156, and I weighed in at the evening at 160.
Nice.
Because I binged so much food. But at the beginning of the day, like... Before I started, I was I was 163.
Okay. So 163 to 156 over 2 weeks.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, cool.
And then give it a day and we'll be back.
Yep.
But back to habit. So, yeah, I was just searching for, like, how can I leverage and change a couple more core habits.
Right on. Okay. So I guess some of the mechanics of this, like, right on the cover, there's a picture of a bunch of guys running in what looks like a hamster wheel. I'm going to be the person that doesn't know squat. Like, why a hamster wheel? What does that mean? How do we build habits? You know, mm-hmm. what were some of the takeaways, the concepts of the book?
Sure. So there's there's a habit loop, and where it starts is it starts over here with a cue, something that gets you engaged, gets you to make an action. So
okay.
it could be seeing an image on a billboard, or maybe a certain song comes on the radio, or the fact that you wake up means it's time to take a shower. And so there's a cue that triggers a routine. So, like, for me, when I wake up, pretty much the first things I do in the day now are I wake up and I take a shower, do my hair, whatever, get cleaned up, get dressed for the day, and go down and make breakfast.
Sure.
And then along with that, I toss in some scripture reading, or doing what I do in my journal. There's a routine there. And then you get a reward. So like from the shower, you get that clean feeling, like,
okay,
I don't feel grimy anymore.
Yeah. So your cue is waking up in the morning.
Yeah,
the routine,
for this habit.
The routine happens to be, you know, shower or eating a healthy breakfast or doing scripture reading, whatever it happens to be, and your reward is that you feel good and you're ready for the rest of the day.
Exactly.
How has that changed before, like, say before you read this book? Did you have a morning routine? Was that not a habit for you?
I mean, we all have morning routines. We all have routines in general. I'm just using this one because the cue is really easy to use, is waking up.
Sure.
That's the cue. But I have changed my morning routine
since
reading this book. So that leads to a more productive day. Like, everyone has a morning routine. Everyone has a routine for anything. We're like, one thing that they hit on in the book was, we're just a culmination of habits. We're just a big pile of habits.
Right.
Because what the brain does is, the body wants to conserve energy, and so it takes a series of actions and turns it into what it calls as chunking. Which is the habit. It creates a routine out of it. So you don't have to think. So, like...
So what percentage of your day is run by habit? Do they have a number in there?
I can't remember the number, but
I've heard it's something like 40 to, you know, 60 or 70%. I mean,
I would definitely...
A lot of your day is just the same thing that you've done in the past. You know how to do it, and it's a habit for you.
Yeah, like driving to work.
Somebody will tell us, I'm sure, if it's totally different.
So back to the habit loop.
Yeah.
By the hamster wheel. So a cue, routine, and then you get a reward. And what happens is, once you get to the reward, it starts over again once you have the same cue.
Okay.
Now, when you're going in the circle, what they found is in testing animals, like hit a button, get some juice or whatever, They hit the button. That's the routine. And then the juice is the reward.
Okay.
And the brain activity actually spikes on the reward the first few times you form the habit. But as you form the habit, our minds crave things. We're addiction machines. And so
okay,
and
fair.
So what happens is, as soon as you get the cue, over time in this habit loop, you create craving. And after you've created that craving, as soon as the cue hits, you get that that spike in brain activity, okay, looking for the reward before you've even gotten the reward.
Sure.
So it's almost like when you have the cue, you've kind of gotten your reward without getting the reward. So then you go through the routine and the reward simply because it's become a habit.
So your brain realizes that a reward is coming when the cue happens.
Yes.
And so you're compelled to go jump into that.
Exactly.
So for example, if I had a habit of buying delicious fries from McDonald's.
Sure.
And every time I see the Golden Arches, my brain starts to crave that. And that leads to the action of driving through the drive-thru,
yeah,
buying them, paying the money,
but the
and
actual,
then the reward.
The actual eating of them and then the reward of feeling full no longer is really a reward because your brain activity...
It's just a response to the craving.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow,
like,
okay.
Your brain activity spikes at the beginning where the cue is, and then it's just habit. It's just
gotcha.
Routine to actually get the fries, to actually eat them and feel the full.
And, that,
and
the that's
full
the
pain.
Same for good habits and for bad habits?
Yes.
So that doesn't bode well for people with bad habits.
Sure.
So
sure.
How does that let's talk a little bit about changing habits. Are all habits the same as far as, you know, impact? Are all of them that eat the same way? Because some people have real addictions. They're you know, struggling with things. Some people just have a habit of, you know, eating salted peanuts in the afternoon,
yeah,
at 4 p.m. Like, there's got to be some different levels.
Sure.
Or I don't know. Could you speak to that?
Yeah, I think first off, if you're trying to change a habit, a lot of people like will try to change the reward or the cue.
Okay.
And then maybe do something different.
Sure.
And it's kind of working backwards. And what is called the golden rule of habit change is actually outlined by Tony Dungy when he was, I think,
the football coach.
Yeah, the football coach. He was coaching the Buccaneers at the time, and they were not doing well. And they started getting better and better. And what he noticed is the golden rule of habit change, he kind of coined, or maybe he didn't coin, but whatever, he was like a founder of it, is negative habits and good habits never go away. But what can go away is your routine. So you keep the same old cue.
Okay.
Maybe it's seeing the, we'll go
with step one.
Yeah, seeing the golden arches. You keep the same reward of maybe the reward is feeling full.
Sure.
But you change the routine. So instead of driving in, maybe you pull off at the next driveway and grab like the peanuts.
Okay.
Or the protein bar that's in your bag, or like I said, the peanuts in
okay.
the. So you're still eating something.
So
you're still
same stimulus,
same reward,
okay,
different routines.
Gotcha. So you have to find something that gives you that same, I don't know, mental high, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
that's healthy for you rather than hurtful for you.
Exactly.
Interesting.
Exactly.
So in the case of the delicious French fries.
For sure.
It might not be eating delicious French fries. It might be something else.
Yeah,
and,
like a good
but
alternative.
But every time you see the McDonald's arches or get that craving, you're doing something different.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. Gotcha.
And then to go on with that, what they kind of broke down after hitting what a golden rule of habit change is what is called keystone habits.
Okay.
And keystone habits means that there's a lot of things happening, a lot of habits happening, but if you find the one that's most important and you change that one, that will inadvertently make changing the habits that are linked to it easier.
Okay.
So for me, I have found through time and time again, if I get my relationship with God on point and I'm in my word every day, journaling, spending time with him, even for a very short amount of time throughout the week, but every day,
okay,
like deliberately with him.
Yeah.
Not to say like throughout the day, like shooting up a prayer or something. But I found for me personally, I don't know what you guys are, what you believe in,
sure,
and I'm not trying to push off my Christianity on you. I'm just saying for me, this is what works the best.
So specifically being in the Word and prayer for you has become, is it a catalyst for other types of change? What do you mean it by just, that keystone habit concept?
It just makes it, it's the one habit that makes the rest of habits change easier.
Okay.
And so it's kind of like a domino effect. Like if you're trying to get dominoes 5, 6, and 7,
right,
and so you just hit number 6 or number 5, maybe those, like, it's almost like they can pop back up. Someone else
has left the other ones untouched.
Yeah, but if you hit the first domino and it's a bigger domino, it will push down the rest of them. It's kind of that way. And it's not as quick as, like, hitting down dominoes, but it's the same type of concept. Hit the first one. Start with the core habit that will ultimately affect the rest.
Okay. So from my understanding, and I've listened to a little bit of podcast. I listened to a different podcast, the Entree Leadership podcast, with Charles Duhigg, the author of this book, and he talks about that a keystone habit like that changes our self-image. Is that
sure?
So in your example, you know, saying I'm going to be the type of person that prays and reads my Bible on a day-to-day basis, that leads you to say I can change, you know, a person who does those things has these other things under control. Is that fair? It's like it's changed your self-image in a certain sense.
Yeah, similar to that is what Tony Robbins talks about too.
Okay, yeah.
He talks about the three S's, but I'm only going to hit on the one. There's strategy, something, and story.
Okay.
I always forget the middle one. But anyway, this book can give you like strategies on how to change habits.
Okay.
And that's cool. Let's see, would it like look really cool?
There you go, now you can see habit.
Oh, look at that.
Perfect.
So, this book,
Tony Robbins and strategy. Yep.
This talks about strategies. It talks about mechanics, how to change specific habits. In the back, there's an appendix that actually goes through, okay, how do I apply all this science behind habits and what and the stories. The cool thing in here is like stories of what people have done. Honestly, reading this just for the stories of positive improvements in other lives, like, really affected me, and I think that's what affects most people is, like...
Sure.
Like for you, for the first month of this year, you did the 4-hour body.
Right, so in 1 month, for those of you who don't know, in 1 month following the slow-carb diet, I went from 24% body fat down to 19, lost 13.5 pounds, and eliminated roughly, you know, 10, you know, inches of circumference around different places in your body that you track with the 4-hour body in the slow carb diet.
Yeah, so I don't
like
wanna...
that story is more powerful to me, mostly because it's my story, but it's more powerful to me than knowing exactly how to do, you know, the diet.
Exactly. And I guess where I'm getting with this is I've been tired of having an average body for so long.
Sure.
I didn't really have like a plan to take care of that.
Okay.
But then when I saw John's story, and I saw that in 1 month he dropped 13 pounds, and all these other things, and the cool thing is minimum effective dose, which is kind of what keystone habits are in here.
Okay.
Is what's the minimum effective dose? What's the least amount of input, the least amount of effort I need to make so that I can get
the biggest
output?
Because people are naturally lazy.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, and
we don't like to make changes.
Y'all might have heard of Pareto's principle. Maybe you haven't. It's the 80-20 rule. If you put in 20% effort, you get 80% of the results.
As long as it's the right 20%.
Yes. And then the last 20% of the results comes from 80% effort. So same thing with like you wear 20% of your clothes 80% of the time. 80-20 rule. So what this does is keystone habit is that 20%.
Okay.
What's that 20%? What's that, or in the other book, the one thing. I think you read that and you had a book review.
Great one too.
Another plug, check that book review out. I haven't read it, but the book review is solid. I guess not getting really off topic, but you can get all these strategies and things.
Okay.
But what you talked
about. Back to Tony Robbins with the story.
Exactly. You mentioned something about if you change the way you think about yourself first.
Sure.
Can you make change? And that's where I'm like segueing us back, bringing this all back around is, If you listen to other people's stories and you can change your own story, that's going to be the biggest catalyst to actually making change in your life.
Okay.
And so, yes, if you want to change something about yourself, first you have to change how you think about yourself.
Okay. That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Is there anything else that I should be asking that I'm not asking about the power of
There's a couple other things I want to hit on.
Okay.
That go along with what we're chatting about.
Okay.
One thing that I found really interesting, there's a couple chapters in here that were like super interesting, like how Target revolutionized like advertising and sending out coupons.
Okay.
Won't get into that though. You guys have to read the book to actually get that one. Or how Starbucks created, you mentioned willpower, and how can I create habits so that I have to use less willpower? There's actually a chapter in the book that talks about how Starbucks made willpower into a habit.
Okay.
So they actually created habits for...
Sounds interesting.
...building willpower.
Yeah.
Again, read the book to get that. but one thing I wanted to hit on, and you see this in politics, you see this in different organizations, and if your mindset is correct when you're leading people, this is key, is crisis.
Okay.
Crisis is critical. And the reason I say that is the most growth people go through is in times of crisis. When you're like pushed up against the wall and you don't have any other bridges, all your bridges are burned and you have one option. What they call this for soldiers is backing yourself into a corner.
Okay.
You know, you don't, or it's called death ground. You
sure.
don't want to approach a soldier on death ground because the only way that soldier lives.
Right.
Is if he beats you. There's no other option
sure.
for him. There's no other thinking
it's,
that's involved.
It's like back in the Civil War during the Battle of Gettysburg when they had Pickett's charge. You know, the guys were out of bullets, but they charged down the hill because they were on death ground at the top of the hill.
Yeah.
I don't remember if it was the south or the north, but Pickett's charge, they literally were, they overcame the opposing forces in that specific scenario because they were on death ground and
wow.
they had no other options. They charged down the hill with their bayonets out and, you know, fought them back.
Yeah. And so what crisis,
I might have the details wrong, but
yeah,
go check out Pickett's charge.
It's still solid.
Yeah.
So what crisis is in the U.S., countries, like a country goes through crisis, like when Lehman's collapsed.
Sure.
When Lehman's collapsed back in 07, end of 07 into 08, Lehman's collapsed, there was so much crisis. A lot changed.
So that's a catalyst for someone to change their habits.
Yes, it creates lots of opportunity. One thing that Tony Robbins is actually promoting is his new book, Unshakable. And what he's saying is, and a lot of successful people say is, when crisis happens, when we have a bear market and everyone's like on the defensive, pulling out of the market, I mean, Grant Cardone talks about this too. That's
sure.
the time to advance. That's the time to expand because there's so much opportunity. And in your own life, when you're in crisis, it puts you in a certain mindset to want to change.
Right. You don't have any choice but to change.
Exactly.
And so if you understand habit, you have the opportunity to make positive change through crisis.
Exactly.
Rather than simply reacting.
Exactly.
Okay.
And I think if you embrace a mindset of crisis will happen, bad things will happen in my life, but before they happen, you stare them in the face. Like, you bring that problem, and instead of it being out there, bring it up front.
Sure.
Look at it straight in the face. Whether that's a death in the family, getting cancer, going bald. I mean, I really don't want to go bald, but my grandpa is super bald. My dad is not. So I know everyone says it's your mom's father. He's the bald.
Shout out to my grandpa.
Yeah, Grandpa Link. He actually turned 90 this
okay.
year, a month ago.
Gotcha.
So yeah, big props to him. But anyway, like going bald, if I stare that in the face, like it's probable that I will go bald. If I think about that before I actually go bald, then when it happens, it's not going to be a big deal.
Okay.
Just like it won't cripple me. Just like if there's a death in the family or if I get cancer, if I embrace that it's possible that I will have cancer before cancer happens, before the crisis happens,
okay.
then my mindset about the crisis is better.
Okay.
And I'm willing to go through that crisis gracefully. And I only say that to
right.
say this. If other people do the same thing, and I'm not saying that about me, that I've done this and I'm phenomenal about it. It's just something I've noticed about other successful people in the world.
Okay.
Is a mindset of
telling
crisis.
Yourself a story that you're self-aware enough that when crisis does happen, you have the opportunity to respond positively.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Interesting.
A couple other things.
Last couple thoughts about power of habit.
Yep,
yeah.
And we'll just wrap it all up. Yeah, we'll just skip to the last one. Is we've kind of hit on this, but we haven't really used the word too much. We've used story and strategy
sure.
and all these other things, but what it breaks down to is belief.
Yeah, so your self-image, what you believe about yourself.
Exactly.
Specifically in habit.
If you believe change can happen, change will happen. And that's really what this comes down to, is belief. And one key line...
How does that work specifically? Because that seems a little cliche.
Okay. Well, there's three levels of habits that the book broke down. Individual. It started out with individual, how habits affect individuals, how habits affect organizations, and then thirdly, how habits can affect communities.
Okay.
And the big thing about belief is, and I remember underlining this, I saw it earlier today when I was kind of going through the book again, just to refresh, and it says, belief in, something along the lines of, belief is much stronger in a community.
Okay.
It's accountability.
Right.
You know, so like going back to For Our Body, we text back and forth about,
sure,
like binge day, or like, yo, this looks really good, but it's in the middle of the week. I'm struggling.
That's
man.
Fair.
Like, I've definitely done that. I'll be like, yo, I'm thinking about getting this. And then I'll later text him like, nope, I got Chipotle without the rice, without the shell.
Sure.
And so we have that. We're building a relationship. And we have more accountability than self-accountability. Ultimately, it does break down to self-accountability, building your self-esteem.
Okay.
But to first do that, a lot of people need to build accountability with others, using okay. others to for, so like you'll
so
see.
So what you're saying is, so I don't cut you off.
No,
but,
you're good.
But your ability to change, your belief in changing in yourself, can sometimes come from social accountability.
Exactly.
So making things public. For example, you know, at least as I'm thinking, you know, through my own story,
yeah.
you know, through 2016, I said I was going to read a book a week and talk about it online in a live, you know, in a YouTube format. And only by making that public and putting my work out there in a public setting mm-hmm. did I have the stamina, I guess you could say, to read a book a week on my own time, because I knew that it was sure. going to be public to everyone else.
Yeah.
So now I've gone through, you know, that process, and I don't read a book a week because my schedule has changed, but I have yeah. that belief that I could if I needed to again, because of, you know, working in that community and building that habit in that capacity. Is that what you're saying?
Can you refresh that? Yeah, sorry, building, the water
sure,
got
sure.
me off topic.
Okay, so building a habit and belief in that in yourself that you can change your own habits, a lot of times comes from making things public, being a part of a community that
yes.
enforces
yes.
those habit changes.
Yes, that's
okay.
why I thought you were going with this. One thing that
sure.
I've noticed, you're doing this, you mentioned it, throwing it out online through YouTube and things.
Sure.
I'm going to read a book a week, and I'm going to post about it online on YouTube.
Right.
And he did it every week. Another thing that people are, like, a lot of people are engaging in a community through social,
right.
through this thing right
sure.
here. Because what has happened is this device right here is the new TV.
Yep.
And so what people are doing is, like, instead of just talking with their closest friends, which with deeper stuff that you don't want public, talking amongst closer friends is good. But I think ultimately, like, what a lot of people are doing now is they'll shoot a quick video saying, hey, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z. I want y'all to keep accountable, whether it's on Instagram or YouTube or whatever. Everyone's doing that. And the reason they're doing that is because they're tapping into that belief through a community. They have a community through the phone.
Sure.
And they're tapping into that belief
okay.
on here. And so to wrap it all up, I think that's it.
Okay.
Is it just boils down to belief. But honestly, I would recommend this to anyone that is tired, wherever you're at in life. If you're tired where you're at, if you want to change some things, this would be a great book. I don't know if you'd want to start with this book. There's a couple other books in building, like, self-awareness and things that are really good to start that. I don't know where you are in the process of
so it's
self-help.
A little bit advanced. It's an intermediate book.
You could say that, really.
Okay.
I mean, you could start with this book if you wanted. It's just going to get you more into, like, semantics, mechanics,
okay.
like, more of the science.
Sure.
Again, there's plenty of stories, so it could work
so
in that
deep,
way.
It's a deep dive on one specific topic rather than a top line, you know, here's how to change things in your life.
Sure.
Okay.
But with the amount of stories, maybe it will make a good first, like, I haven't read any self-help. I'll start with this one. There's That's a lot fair. Of stories, so it will build that belief through other people's stories. I'm not sure, but I just like that I came across this after reading other books. But ultimately, if you're looking for getting better individually, or if you're already in that process, get the book. If you're happy with where you're at and you don't care to change at all, this isn't for you. And disregard what we've said, because
absolutely.
I mean, go watch whatever videos on YouTube you're already watching. Be happy.
The ones that Ty Lopez gets in front of.
Be happy with the job you're already at. Sure. Be happy with seeing getting caught up in other people's big rings, other people's cool cars, other people's whatever. I mean, it's cool, but if you're already getting caught up in that and you're getting your sense of satisfaction by other people's results, don't read the book. Okay. But if you want results in your own life, read the book. Get the book. It's worth the $20, $15.
Yep.
I mean, to invest in your future for $15, do it. If you don't care about your future, keep your $15 and go buy McDonald's 3 times.
That's fair. Thank you for for jumping on the
podcast. It was loads of fun.
Yeah, go check this out if you want to change something in your life. Also, let us know what you think of the new format. If you like it, we'll keep doing them. If not, we might still keep doing them because this is actually kind of fun. I enjoy having conversations. And I think there's some interesting things that come out in two different perspectives rather than, just me trying to figure out what's in a book, that sort of thing. So like and share if you liked it. If not, hopefully this will go up on YouTube if we can figure out how to download it and re-upload it to YouTube.
One thing I want to put out there.
Sure, you have anything you want to plug? Or?
I have nothing to plug right now.
Okay.
I mean, you can check out my Instagram,
what's your handle?
Twitter. My handle is Shannon Oliver.
Okay.
It's real simple, but it's spelled a little bit differently. It's one word, but the last name is spelled O-L-L-Y-V-E-R.
We can put it on screen if we put this on YouTube.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We'll jump
on screen.
I also
tagged you on YouTube, or on the Facebook Live.
The reason, my nickname from someone is Ali,
gotcha.
Spelled with a Y. So I figured
That's
no fair. One's going to have that handle,
right.
But it's still my name. So anyway, check out. But what I want to ask you is, do you like the fact that we are in a live environment? Things are
sure.
happening. I mean, there's people back here. There's people all around.
Shout out to our friends.
Yeah, with live plants, like, do you want to see more like live environments?
Yeah.
Or I just wanted to put that out there for this guy because it's his podcast. Enjoyed it.
I really want to have feedback on this because I will do more podcast style things rather than a thought through quick video if people enjoy that.
Yeah.
So, right on, man.
Dude, I was really excited about this. We'll have to do this again.
Yeah, absolutely. Hit me up anytime you read another great book that you beat me to.
Sure.
All right.
Sure, I have a couple.
Catch you guys later. I will see you next week, 2 weeks.